So the thing also that was interesting to me was that Eduardo is kind of building a product, so it's not a SaaS, but a machine learning platform product from scratch, basically. And he's both providing it to the internal users and to the external users, so the users of GitLab itself and the machine learning teams inside of the organization. So I'm used also to building internal platforms for inside of organizations. But in my case, it was always different, because when you're actually building an internal platform for a company, you're kind of stitching usually open source or not open source tooling together to provide a set of capabilities, but you are not building something from scratch. And it's super different when it comes to SaaS, right?
I think they are not building it from scratch. I think they are building it based on the MLflow. They just don't use the server or UI part. That makes sense because this UI is not great. And it would be hard to integrate with other services of GitLab. But they are building it on top of the protocol, on top of MLflow client from Python perspective. And in this way, you know, the data model behind MLflow is okay. You're not using the backend, but if you're using the API, you're basically taking the data model with you. So I think it's a very smart way how to deliver value quickly, not from scratch, but at the same time in a way that allows you to develop it further. So I find it not so far from how you would do it in an ML platform team. Maybe if you are an ML platform team, you are not necessarily in the business of providing a custom UI, and that's why you can be maybe in the first iteration you'd be fine with using MLflow UI, or eventually replace it with Neptune UI, but I don't see that it is so different.
Maybe the thing that is different here is this piece of minimal viable change, right? Because when you bring the entire tool and you use it, so you have the entire set of capabilities at once. And when you're building like Eduardo does, you kind of have to build a capability after capability one by one. So how do you choose which ones do you need to provide? And to me, it was a little bit, not necessarily weird, but I didn't expect that. The first thing that you need to do is just what you would like to do is just expose the metadata as a table. And the next thing that he is trying to do now is model registry. So we don't have any plots yet, right? We can't compare any plots.
But to be honest, I don't see that this is the only way, because we had a discussion like that yesterday or today in my product team around reports. So there was a question, okay, shall we bring comments first, or maybe work more on the what information, like will we allow people to add visualizations from experiments into the reports? And for me it was obvious, like, yes, we need to have visualization first, and in this case data first, in order to visualize them. In our case, we need to have visualizations in the reports first, because you will be adding comments on top of them. It doesn't make sense to comment report without content. The same, it doesn't make sense to have visualizations without data that will be filled to the visualizations.
No. What I actually meant is that we are now prioritizing model registry before they are prioritizing the visualizations on the experiments, right? So
it is very much GitLab-ish, I would say. You're going broad in a shallow way, right? You try to connect the dots, you try to cover the whole spectrum, and then in the areas where you see traction, you go deeper. Still not super deep, but they have a very broad mission and vision as a product. So I'm not surprised, but I've studied a lot GitLab's culture, and it is very much in line.